Thank you, worship team. Thank you for leading us in that powerful time of worship. And good morning, church. Good morning to each and every one of you. We're so glad you could join us once again through, this recording, and you know, worship God together as a church family. And I hope and pray that you're keeping strong, and that you're looking for God in everything that is going on in your life, going on around you. And you know, that is what we need in this journey, to be close to God and to be hearing from God. And I just hope and pray that each one of us are strong and are seeking God in that manner. So before we go into our time of hearing from God's word, let's take this time to make our declaration bold and strong.
Before we do our declaration, I'd like to quickly read with you Genesis chapter 1 verses 1 to 3. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was on the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. So we see God, who is the creator, the architect, and the designer, brought things to pass. When there was darkness, he said, "Let there be light," and there was light. But God, in his goodness, did not stop there. He continued on and said, "Let us make man in our image and our likeness." So we, as we are meant to be imitators of God, we are also meant to speak in the middle of our circumstances. We're meant to speak God's word in the middle of our darkness or any challenges or any obstacles that we may be facing. And we can be assured that we can bring in a permanent change in that situation just by speaking God's word over that situation and being imitators of God by doing so. So on that note, can you lift your Bibles up high and get ready to do your declaration loudly and boldly? This is God's word. This is God speaking to me. I am who God says I am. I can do what God says I can do. I will become everything God has promised. I am saved, healed, delivered, redeemed. I am blessed, victorious, prosperous, triumphant. I am a minister of God, a servant of Christ, and a channel of His blessing to many people. I receive His word, I believe His word, and I live by His word. Christ is my master. To Him I am in absolute surrender. I present myself as a new wineskin, to receive the new wine and fresh oil being poured out on me. God releases new things and a new work of His Spirit in me and through me. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Sam, for leading us in that time of declaration. And this morning, church, I know each one of us, we're going through different things in our lives. You know, it's been 6 months into this year, and we have another 6 months to go through and to look ahead. As we are in this point in the year, I felt that it would be good for us to continue on this theme of endurance, because we are enduring to see what God has promised fulfilled in our lives. And generally, you know, at the start of the year, we come up with so many resolutions. You know, some of us decide to read more books. Then there are others of us who want to eat better, eat healthier. And then there are some others who want to exercise more. So there are all kinds of resolutions. But when we look at the statistics of those who have completed doing what they set out to do, you know, it's really sad to see that it's quite a small number. In fact, some studies say that only about 8% finish what they had intended to do. As we are considering going strong for the coming months, you know, I want us to be encouraged. Wherever we are in our journey of doing what God has called us to do, you know, the important thing is for us to continue doing it and finish it, because God wants us to finish what we has what he has put on our hearts. And so that's the encouragement that I want to bring to us this morning. And the points that I'm going to share, I've put it in alphabetical order so that there is some recall, and it helps us apply these crucial keys in our journey of completing the race. So the first and foremost thing that I want to share with us about finishing something that we have started is to desire to finish well. So aim to finish. Aim to finish. Without an aim to finish, it's very difficult to go through an entire journey. When we consider life is a marathon, and so is our journey of faith. We need endurance to go through this entire journey and to reach the finish line. So Hebrews chapter 12, there we read about life being a race. The Greek word race is agona, which means there's some amount of struggle involved. There is conflict involved in this race or this journey of life that we are undertaking. And in this journey of life, the sooner we understand that we are here for the long term and it's not a short sprint, it gives us the opportunity to plan well, to desire to finish well. Now, I am reminded of the example of Paul the Apostle. And Paul the Apostle, of course, patterned his life after the life of Jesus. Jesus completed the mission that God had called him to complete, and Jesus exclaimed, it is finished. And in the same way, Paul looks at his life, his ministry, and he expresses his desire to complete it well. In Acts chapter 20 and verse 24, he says something like this. He says that, but none of these things move me, nor do I count my life dear to myself, so that I may finish my race with joy and the ministry which I received from the Lord Jesus to testify the gospel of the grace of God. So Paul was looking to finish his race with joy and complete what God had called him to do. So today, the call for each one of us is to maintain that desire. Maybe when we started out doing what God called us to do, we had that desire to finish. But as things are getting challenging and things are getting tougher, but there's always that temptation to throw in the towel. But like Paul the Apostle, can we too look at this journey and say that we desire to finish, aim to finish? Now, not only did Paul do this for himself, but he taught the same thing to the people who came after him. Now, Timothy is somebody he mentored, and this is what he wrote to Timothy. In 2 Timothy 4, verses 7 and 8, Paul says, I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith. Finally, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on that day, and not to me only, but also to all who have loved his appearing. So Paul is exhorting Timothy to do the same thing, to finish the race that God has given him. So this morning, church, I want us to maintain that desire to finish. Don't lose that desire to finish. Aim to finish. And how do we continue to keep this desire to finish? When we equip ourselves for the entire journey and we fix our eyes on the finish line, we're able to prepare ourselves to keep running and to reach the destination. So the first thing it would be preparation. And so I would say that we have to really count the cost of reaching the finish line. And this is something Jesus taught in Luke 14. No, Jesus says that anybody who is intending to build a tower, does he not sit down first and count the cost, whether he has enough to finish it? And I believe it's true for us in whatever it is that God has called us to do. We have to think about the finish at the start. So count the cost and think of all that is required from us for us to finish this race. The second thing for us to keep that desire and aim to finish is for us to value all the different goals that God has given us. So the Bible also says that among everything that we do, we have to aim to especially do well in the spiritual goals. And this is something that Paul wrote to Timothy in 1 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 8. Now he tells him that for bodily exercise profits a little, but godliness is profitable for all things. So value the spiritual things, value spiritual goals above all the other goals. And of course, know that while the destination is important, God wants us to enjoy the journey. Now, God is working in our lives, and through the journey, you know, God is also changing us and molding us into the kind of people that He wants us to be. And there are many scriptures that talk about this process that you and I go through when we walk with God, when we are obedient to the call of God. In fact, in James 1, verses 2 to 4, in that passage, you know, we are told that God is building in patience, and He is perfecting us, He is completing us as we cooperate with Him. So as we consider all of these things, you know, we are charged up, we are enthused to keep running this race. We have the aim to finish as we fix our eyes on the finish line. So that's the first key for us: desire to finish, aim to finish. The second key for us to finish strong is to build strength. Now, completing any race requires energy, it requires time, and it requires a lot of stamina. And the longer the race, the more the stamina that is required. And so, for us to prepare ourselves for this journey of life, which is actually a marathon, you know, we have to build strength and a lot of stamina to do what God is calling us to do. And for us to run this marathon, you know, we just can't wake up one day, decide to run a marathon and win it. You know, maybe it can happen once, but it cannot happen every time. For us to be able to win a marathon, there is training that will be involved. So we can't just wake up and try to finish the race and finish it, but we have to train to finish it. Now, when we look at the world of sports, when we consider athletes, sometimes they train for years together, and it's safe to say that they even train for a lifetime for a short race. Now, I am reminded of the 2009 world record that Usain Bolt made. You know, it was just a 100 meter sprint, but he finished that race in about 9.58 seconds, and he trained over a long period of time to just complete one race, which would take him less than 10 seconds. So just think about our lives, just think about the kind of strength that we have to build into our lives for us to reach everything, you know, both the spiritual goals and all the other goals that God has given us. So build strength. We as a generation, you know, sometimes we struggle because we have a desire for instant gratification, and that's the kind of world that we live in, where things move really fast, and whatever we need is just, you know, not even a phone call away, but maybe just a tap away. And we want immediate results. But when we consider building strength, you know, building strength does not happen overnight. Building strength involves some amount of pain. It involves stretching. You know, it involves time under tension. As they say, to build lean muscle, you got to have some time under tension, right? So building strength is going to involve some amount of pain. It is unpleasant, and as we stretch, we can expect some kind of growth to take place, and this growth too will take time. But eventually, you know, when you plant a seed in the soil, eventually, as we nurture it, we will see the blade come up, and then the plant, and then, you know, at some point, the harvest. So it is going to take time for us to fulfill these goals that God has put in our hearts, and we need to keep running. And as we're running, let's build strength, build personal strength, build personal strength both for our spiritual goals and you know every other goal in our lives, our spiritual goals are to become more like Jesus, to grow in prayer, to worship God more, to fast, to read the word, and so on and so forth. And we can keep investing into those things, and we'll see a real growth and a real change being seen in us. And in the same way, other goals could be those of our career, where we are upskilling ourselves, we are getting better at technology, or you know, learning different things that our particular job requires, or these skills could, these things could have to do with our health, getting better in our health, or our relationships. So build personal strength, and that will keep us strong. It will keep us on the track. So the first thing is to aim to finish. The second one is to build strength. The third key that will help us keep running this race is to commit to the vision. Now, God is a God of plan. He's a God of design. God has a dream for your life and for my life. And God puts that dream in our hearts, and He wants us to run after that. And we have to get a hold of that vision. For us to finish strong, we need to know what we are running for. Because if we cannot answer that question, what are you running for? What am I running for? You know, it's easy to quit midway. But when we have the answer to that question, what am I running for? Who am I running for? You know, it's easy to keep going even when things get tough. So get a hold of the vision that God has for you. Here's a very familiar verse from Proverbs 29, verse 18. It says, "Where there is no revelation, the people cast off restraint, but happy is he who keeps the vision." So where there is no revelation, where there's no vision, where there's no, when we don't have a goal, when we're not looking at the end result, it's very easy to quit. So get a hold of the vision. Now, the kind of vision that God gives us, you know, we can talk about a lifetime vision, or a, you know, a life goal that God gives us. For example, Jesus had this life vision to redeem us, and that's why he went to the cross. And if we talked about the life of Paul, you know, Paul, at the very moment that he was he was changed on the road to Damascus, God gave him the vision for his life and said that he would be an apostle to the Gentiles. So Paul was living to fulfill that life dream. Now, the life vision is going to take our entire lifetime to complete. However, God also plants assignments in our hearts which have to do with different seasons in our lives. And some good examples would be those of Solomon. Now, Solomon had this vision to build the temple. And similarly, when you look at the life of Zerubbabel, Zerubbabel had the vision to rebuild a ruined temple. So God gave people assignments in different phases of their lives, and when that was done, you know, God handed them new assignments. So maybe today we're saying that I know my life assignment, but I'm really struggling in this particular assignment that God has given me in this season of my life. But you know, don't give up. Hold on to that vision. Commit to that vision and keep running with it. Now, some of us could be waiting on the promises of God. Now, we don't necessarily call these goals or anything, but maybe we're waiting to see God's breakthrough in our business. We are waiting for healing to manifest in the body of one of our loved ones. But standing on those promises is also giving into the vision of God's glory, where we are waiting to see the powerful work of God. So whatever it is, you know, whatever that dream, whatever that vision, hold on to it. Commit yourself to it. Now, I'm reminded of Hebrews 11:13, where it talks about the patriarchs of faith. Some of them saw the promise fulfilled in their lifetime, but there were many others who even tasted death without having walked into the things that God had shown them, in their lifetime. But one of the things that they did is that they saw the vision from afar off and they embraced it. And so today, if God is ministering to us and He is giving us a vision which He wants us to run with. I think the best thing for us to do is to embrace that vision, commit to that vision. When we are committed to the vision, you know, it's very, very difficult for the enemy to stop us in this journey, and we can reach the finish line. So hold on to that vision, run with the vision. One is to get the vision, the second is to do the vision. So put your hands to work. The Bible has so much to say about the diligent hand that works and sees riches. So let's put our hands to work, and we will see the fruit, and we will see what God does for us. And even as we do that, you know, sometimes we can be pulled down because we look at the past, but always look ahead and keep going forward, knowing that as you're holding on to this call that God has given us, you know, God will empower us and God will keep leading us. So now we come to the fourth point. You know, we talked about aiming to finish, building strength, committing to the vision, and then now we're talking about developing consistency. So in our lives, we end up becoming what we do often or what we do regularly. So consistency plays a key role in staying in the race. What is consistency? Consistency is basically a commitment to long-term goals. You know, it means that we are obedient. We are showing long obedience in the same direction, and we keep doing what God has called us to do. So I can think of David. We sing about David being a warrior and winning so many battles. We sing about David slaying the giant Goliath, but you know, David had his humble beginnings, and even then he was consistent. He put his faith in God, and you know, he was slaying the lion and the bear when nobody was even aware that he was doing these things. But consistency, whatever our lion and bear looks like right now, you know, we are still fighting those battles. And as we are consistently fighting battles in our lives, big and small, you know, God prepares us and then He positions us for bigger battles, but that helps us to stay in the race. Today, some of us might look at our lives and say, hey, I haven't been that consistent. You know, there are points in this journey of fulfilling God's purpose and living for God's assignment that I have stumbled. But you know, the Word of God truly encourages us, and in Proverbs 24:16 we see that a righteous man may fall seven times, but he rises up. So this morning, church, and I want to encourage us, as we are pursuing the goal of God unto the finish line, even if there are moments where we find ourselves weak and we have stumbled, you know, God is a gracious God, and this is God's voice speaking to us, saying rise up and get back in the journey, realign yourself and keep running to the finish line, and build that consistency in what God is calling us to do. So let's keep building consistency, and many times building consistency begins by achieving little things. And let's not be discouraged with small beginnings. You know, the Bible has a lot to say about small beginnings. Do not despise the day of small beginnings. He who is faithful in little will also be faithful in much. So we continue, even if we're seeing small results, knowing that at the right time, we will see the breakthroughs that we need, and God will lead us. So gradual growth is still growth, and we must stay the course and not give up. Build consistency. Just look at what God is showing to the point that we're able to see right now. And when we get to that point, you know, God is gracious enough to shed light on the next step. So keep it consistent and keep moving forward. Now here's the next point for us to keep running this race and finishing well. And this point is the longest point, and the point is called endure. So I hope you will endure through this point with me. But you know, as we go through this journey of life, there are phases where things are really smooth, and we breeze through those phases. But then there are these other phases that are really hard, and we have to face stormy weather, but whatever it is we are going through, you know, there is a need to endure, meaning we must not give up, we must stay put, we must stay under pressure, hold on to the goal and trust that God will bring us out. For things to come to fruition, you know, it takes time. And once again, you know, there is a need to endure. It's only when we endure that we will reach the finish line. Now, it's easier actually to quit. Some of us may want to quit. And, you know, when we're going through difficult seasons, the temptation sometimes is for us to say that I cannot do this anymore. But quitting brings a loss. Okay, if we can just endure for another step, we will get closer to the point of reward. There is a reward on the other side of the finish line. So don't quit. There are rewards for finishing and finishing well. So don't forfeit the prize by quitting, but endure. Now, I ask myself this question often, how to endure, how to go through these difficult things that are happening in life and still keep the joy and still keep the energy and still keep running in the race. Now, Hebrews chapter 12 is a great passage for us to lean back on. And I'm going to quickly read some of the verses from there, from verse 1. Therefore, we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him who endured such hostility from sinners against himself, lest you become weary and discouraged in your souls. You have not yet resisted to bloodshed, striving against sin, and you have forgotten the exhortation which speaks to you as to sons. So, you know, we are reminded here that we must look unto Jesus. You know, verse 2 says, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. And then verse 3 says, for consider him. So it's when we look at our role model, our example, the Lord Jesus, that we are filled with that godly energy to keep enduring in whatever it is that you and I are going through. Because Jesus went through pain, you know, he went through rejection, he went through an incredible amount of pressure, and then he died for us on the cross of Calvary. But what kept him going? No, he fixed his eyes on the purpose and destiny which God had for him. Jesus was aware that whatever he was going through momentarily, that it was accomplishing something great for the kingdom of God. So Jesus maintained this heavenly perspective. Yes, he despised the shame of the cross, but he also looked to the joy which was ahead of him, which means that Jesus fixed his eyes on the outcome. Jesus looked at the reward for all the agony that he would go through, which is your redemption and my redemption. So he fixed his eyes on that joy and he kept going and he completed what God had called him to do. So Jesus has endured. Now Jesus had that focus and Jesus withstood under pressure. Jesus endured. And that's the call that we have today for us to endure whatever it is that we are going through. Because if he could endure, you know, we are going through nothing in comparison to what Jesus went through. And so we can endure. So we are inspired by the example of Jesus. And as we're enduring through our journey, we can face enemies. Now, enemies can either be internal or they can be external. Many of these enemies are spiritual enemies and we have to fight them with spiritual weapons. Now, here are some of the internal enemies that you and I could be battling. And most of these enemies are from the battlefield of our mind, where our mind wants us to believe that we cannot reach the finish line. Our natural mind and our carnal mind, but when we renew ourselves with renew our minds with the Word of God, you know, we are able to have that resolve which will keep us going till the finish line. So what are some of these internal hindrances or internal enemies, as we're calling them today? Now, we could experience a sense of inadequacy where we feel that even though God has called us to do something, we're not capable to do it. But the truth is that when God calls us to do something, He always empowers us. So along with the call comes the grace of God to run and fulfill what God wants us to fulfill. So we could be facing a battle with the sense of inadequacy, or there can be intimidation where we're looking at others who are doing so much better than us and we're just not able to start, or somewhere along the journey we want to quit because we're not doing as well as others. So a spirit of intimidation can also stop us. How about anxiety, you know, where we are unable to control things and unable to manage the emotions, you know, that are bringing us down. So there could be a sense of anxiety where we want to do something but we're unable to do it, and you know that causes a lot of turmoil in our emotions. So anxiety is another challenge. There could be ambiguity when we don't have the vision very clear. It's difficult to keep running. So that can affect our consistency and our speed of running till the finish line. And then of course we could also become weary and fatigued. You know, it seems like a very unlikely enemy, but you know, after having run a long distance, the danger is to come really close to the finish line, really close to completing what God has called us to do, and at that point give up because of fatigue or even boredom. So weariness, fatigue and boredom can cause us to quit, and we have to be careful about that spirit of weariness. Also, the fear of failure. You know, when we do not renew our minds with the Word of God and who we are in Christ, Satan can keep accusing us and condemning us, reminding us of our past failures, which will keep us from going ahead with God. So, fear of failure and memories of the past can stop us. There can also be distractions that come along the way, or just a heart of unforgiveness that we carry, which can slow us down in our journey with God, and also fleshly weaknesses. You know, many times our fleshly weaknesses, our desire to indulge in things that God does not want us to get involved in. You know, those things, as Hebrews points out, those are the weights that we must lay aside and grow in discipline. You know, just a lack of discipline will also get us off track. So these are the internal enemies that we could be facing. We have to recognize them and fight against them. Now, we can also have external enemies. And the Bible says that, you know, we go through trials, we go through tribulations, we go through temptations as we go along in this journey of life, and we have to be equipped to face what is coming our way. Now, it takes wisdom, it takes familiarity with the Word of God and the voice of God for us to understand what to endure and what to resist. So when we know that, you know, we're going through something that requires for us to endure, we can stay put in that journey because we know that at the end of that journey there is a reward. And the greatest a good example of someone who went through the journey while facing external enemies is Nehemiah. You know, Nehemiah went to build the wall, the broken down wall, and at that point, you know, there were people who stood up against him, but Nehemiah learned very quickly that he needs to maintain personal strength. He needs to maintain the morale of the people who are serving together with him, and you know, he has to complete this race which God has called him to. And so he goes ahead, you know, with prayer and with encouragement and keeping his moral integrity. He together with the people, finishes building the wall in 52 days. And so Nehemiah is a good example of someone who faced external enemies and yet completed what God had called him to do. So we can face our enemies. We can fight whether they are internal enemies or external enemies, and we can go to the finish line. So never give up. Overcome whatever enemy we are facing, and keep learning, keep moving forward, because we know that when we finish, there is a reward. There is always a reward for enduring, and there are ample scriptures that encourage us to complete for a reward. The one who receives the prize is the one who endures. He who endures till the end is saved. The seed that remains bears much fruit. When we sow without being weary, we reap. A crown is rewarded to the one who overcomes temptation. We will hear the master's voice saying, "Well done, good and faithful servant." So there are rewards for finishing well. And so let's endure wherever we are meant to endure and expect a reward from God. So thank you for enduring through that point. Now we move on to the next point, which is to stay firm and steadfast. Now, after having stood in the fight, after having run in the race, what we are really required to do is to stand some more and run some more, because the journey may feel really, really long. But stay firm and stay steadfast. Here is where I'm reminded of the scripture in Hebrews 6 and verse 12. That you do not become sluggish, but imitate those who through faith and patience inherit the promises of God. This is where we have to employ faith and patience. Now, faith, we are reminded of Abraham, who waited for 25 years for the fulfillment of God's promise to him. Now, we are reminded of Caleb, who received a promise as a young man, and he was almost 80 years when he still held on to the promise, and he said, "Give me my mountain." Faith is essential for us to stand firm and to keep moving forward till the finish line. And then, of course, there is need for patience. We require patience. As I shared earlier, when we sow a seed, there is some amount of time that goes by as we nurture that seed, and it takes time for us to see that seed become that seed showing up as a plant, so on and so forth. So patience is very, very important. And those who have received the promises of God, as Hebrews 6:12 says, they had both faith and had patience. And then, of course, in James 5, there's a reminder of the life of Job, who also maintained patience, who looked to the Lord, and God came through for him in the end. So maintain that patience and remain firm, remain steadfast. Now, 1 Corinthians 15 and verse 58, "Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your labor is not in vain in the Lord." And church, this morning, I want to remind us, whatever it is that we are doing for the Lord, be encouraged. Your labor is not in vain. And if we hold on, we will see the victory of God. So let's move on to the next point, which is about depending on God. So God strengthens us. So in this race, the beautiful thing is that we are not alone, and we don't have to do it alone. The Holy Spirit of God, He's on the inside of us. The anointing of God teaches us all things, Scripture says, and God strengthens us in this journey. So fix your eyes on the Lord Jesus. When we talk about receiving strength to keep moving forward, the familiar passage, Isaiah 14 verse 31, it says, "But those who wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint." So this is the antidote to weariness. Now, coming into the presence of God, receiving His strength, being renewed, recharged, and keep running forward. Now God is a God of breakthrough. In 2 Samuel 5:20, we read that God broke through for David in one of his battles, right? And at that 2 Samuel 5:20, and I'm going to read it for us. So David went to Baal-perazim, and David defeated them there, and he said, "The Lord has broken through my enemies before me like a breakthrough of water." Therefore, he called the name of that place Baal-perazim. So God is a God who breaks through on our behalf. You know, as we endure, as we stand firm and steadfast, let's know that even though the battle belongs to the Lord, we are cooperating with Him, and our God will break through for us. And I just want to speak that over our lives this morning, that God will break through for you. And our God is a God of impossibilities. And this is where we get our strength, by being in God and depending completely on God. So God strengthens us. And finally, hope keeps us afloat. So as we are journeying to fulfill the call of God, the assignment of God for our lives, let's keep hope afloat. Hope is a choice, right? Hope is a choice, and we have to focus on God. We have to focus on the result of our labor, which is glory to the name of God. And as we do that, hope is maintained in our hearts, and we are able to run till the finish line. So how to keep this hope alive? Always remember who we are running for. Colossians 3:23, it says, "Whatever you do, do it unto the Lord." So when we're doing things unto the Lord, it's very difficult to feel weary, because we're doing it for the Lord, and the Lord strengthens us. So let's keep that in our hearts. Whatever we're doing for the Lord. Know that others also are pressing through. 1 Peter 5 verses 8 and 9, it says that the same sufferings that you are experiencing, know that your brotherhood in the world, they too are experiencing. So knowing that others are journeying, others are enduring, also strengthens us. And of course, we have Hebrews 11, where we read about so many men and women of faith who have received the promises of God. So know that others are also on a journey to the finish line, and never lose sight of the heavenly perspective. Knowing that some of the things that we go through, they are momentary afflictions in the light of eternity, and this will keep our hope alive. And it is really important for us, and especially in such a season where we hear so much of negative news, for us to stay inspired in God, for us to stay encouraged in God. And so stay inspired, make every effort to safeguard that inspiration. And even if we're feeling weary, it's okay to pause, but get back up and stay in the race and finish the race. Right now, I'd like to request our worship team to come and lead us in a time of worship. And after that, we'll come back and pray together.
All who are thirsty and all who are weak, come to the fountain. Dip your heart in the stream of life. Let the pain and the sorrow be washed away in the wave of His mercy, as deep cries out to deep. We sing, "Come, Lord Jesus, come. Come, Lord Jesus, come. Come, Lord Jesus, come. Come, Lord Jesus, come. All who are thirsty fountain. Keep your heart in the streams of life. Got the pain and the sorrow. We wash away in the wave of His mercy. As deep cries out to
Thank you, worship team. And before we pray together, I want to read a scripture for us. This is from Zechariah chapter 4 and verse 9. It says, "The hands of Zerubbabel have laid the foundation of this temple. His hands shall also finish it. Then you will know that the Lord of hosts has sent me to you." So this day, church, whatever it is that you and I are going through, even if there's a sense of, I want to give up, I don't want to fight anymore. Now let's remember that the God who causes us to start our journeys is the God who will empower us to finish. You know, God picked Zerubbabel to complete the rebuilding of the temple. And so beautiful, you know, this verse says that his hands, they laid the foundation of this temple, and his hands shall also finish it. So God's word came to him, and that word empowered him to complete the work that God had called him to do. And even this morning, we can depend on the word of God, which will strengthen us to complete this journey. Let's always remember that He who began a good work in us will be faithful to complete it. And today, no matter what you and I are going through, we can make our confession and say that I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And we stand in the grace of God. We stand with the strength of God, and we will move on with His power till the finish line. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the dreams that you have planted in each one of our hearts. Lord, we thank you, God, even right now, the assignments that we are engaged in, and Lord, the vision that we're looking at, Father God. Thank you, Lord, that the vision will truly come, Lord, and God, that it will not tarry, Father God. And so, Lord Jesus, this morning, Lord, we stand and affirm our faith that, Lord, you are the author and you are the finisher, Lord, in our lives. And God, that you will give us the grace to keep running and to finish this journey. And Lord, I just pray that, Lord, we will see your miracles, Father God, in every aspect of our lives. Lord, this day we stand and declare that, God, you are victorious. The enemy is crushed, Father God. He is under our feet. And Lord, we declare the victory of the cross, Father God, in all circumstances. God, we pray that we will see unusual interventions, Lord. We will see unusual miracles taking place in our lives. And God, above all, Lord, we pray, Father God, that Lord, we will see an arising, Lord Jesus. Lord, and I just want to speak over Lord, your church and say that arise, shine, for your light has come, for the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. Though darkness cover the earth and deep darkness the people, yet the Lord will arise over you and his glory shall be seen upon you. And Father God, even as your glory, Lord, shines on us, Lord, we thank you for the healings, God. We thank you for the breakthroughs. Lord, we thank you for doing the impossible in our lives. And God, we give you all the glory, Lord. We give you all the honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you, church. Thank you for journeying together with us. And, you know, we pray that you will experience breakthroughs and that all of us will finish and that we will finish strong. So stay with the assignment. Stay with the vision of God. Keep the faith. Keep going strong. Finish strong. God bless you. Have a great week ahead.